confirm if you can hear my voice and if you can see my video clearly. Quickly type yes in the chat. Yes, yes, yes. Perfect. So we have a very special guest today. His name is Kashif Raza. He'll be taking us through a lot of Web3 concepts that we have learned before. He'll be recapping it. A lot of the things that we have learned before and also deep diving in. If you are just beginning, as we have seen, a lot of people that we have are beginners. How to move forward? What are the things to look up to? What is your pathway when you think about Web3? So very quickly, today we'll talk about fundamentals of Web3. Again, recap, talking about NFTs, DeFi, DAOs, why are these necessary? Why are people jumping to these? And also we'll spend a lot of time on the Q&A because we see a lot of questions coming in when you learn more. So one second, let me check if everything is fine. Perfect. Kashif, can you hear my voice okay? Are we good to go?
Yeah, so can you hear me?
Yeah, we can. Your video is
out. Yeah, I'm coming up with my video. The voice is loud and clear.
Yeah, the voice is acting perfect. Yeah.
Just a second.
Sure.
All right. So can you see me now?
One sec. Yeah, we can see you now.
But I can't see my face. I mean, what I've... All right. So do I need to share the screen and...
Yeah.
All right.
Folks, we'll really appreciate if you can turn on your cameras. It'll be a very interactive session that we're going to have today. So very appreciate if you can open the cameras up. Thank you so much, Anil. Thank you so much, Sumit and Vikas, for doing that. Yeah, Kashif,
So thank you very much. Thank you very much, guys. And thanks for joining this session. I think this is very important. Not from the perspective of, we want to understand that not from the perspective of having an understanding of this space, but also, there are a lot of myths and a lot of confusion around this space. And, me as an individual is not a techie, by the way. So I'm not an IT and I'm not an engineer. I'm a pure sales guy. I've spent most of my life in sales. So what advantage that I've got, after making my career in this space is that, once you are non-techie, so you're able to understand this industry from a perspective of a layman. And when you try to explain the concept, you try to explain it in a way that they're very easy to understand. Because when I entered into this industry, I wanted to understand this industry from a very layman perspective. What happens when you understand it from an engineer, with all due respect to them, because they have a very technical understanding of it. And I have a very philosophical understanding of it. So crypto is basically, amalgamation of philosophy and technology. So Satoshi, if you see, when the Bitcoin evolved, it's more of a philosophy and then, technology. So if there wouldn't have been a philosophy today, what we are talking about at this moment, like Web3, Bitcoin, crypto, we wouldn't have achieved to this level because the philosophy of decentralization, philosophy of securing our privacy, taking charge of our privacy, those philosophies actually motivated a lot of people in this industry to make things that we are seeing today. And my job in this space is to educate more and more people. So I've been into this space for the past 6 years. Prior to this, I was into my corporate job, and I have close to 16 years of experience. I have worked with companies like UTV, Disney, Sony Pictures, and I've worked with PepsiCo, so IndiaMart.com. So I've worked with these companies for 15, 16 years. And then in 2016, I got into crypto. And my journey was a little weird. I started on a bad note by investing most of my crypto in a Ponzi scheme. So that moment was pretty weird in my life. And from that moment onwards, I said, okay, if I could be fooled around, So, you know, going forward, I took it as a mission that my rest of my life, I want to spend in education in this space so that, you know, people should not look at this industry from a Ponzi perspective, you know, because there are a lot of narratives where people will say this is a Ponzi scheme and all that. But I think this is the new internet, new web we are talking about. In 2016, it was not clear. But now when you connect the dots, you are seeing that every single step that is being taken in this industry is taking us forward to a better internet. And that is what humans are all about. So if you allow me, then let's continue because we already have a very lesser time. I think you have given me, what, 30 minutes?
Yeah, maybe 30 to 40 minutes. Yeah,
30 to 40 minutes. Oh my God, this is a very less of a time. What motivated you after being fooled for the first, very first time? I'll answer everything. Jatin, I'll answer that. Because my slides are a little... I'll answer... At the end of the session, I can answer my personal... this thing as well. My personal journey as well in detail. So let's start and let's... you know, try to finish it within time. It's already 8:08. So let me just share the screen. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, it's visible now.
Is it visible now?
Yeah, we are. It's at the last slide.
Oh, sorry. So we are at the last slide. So just wanted to thank you. Let's start from hello. That's the right way. Okay. So good evening once again, guys. And this is a very important session. I personally wanted to take this session because I think this is very important. As most of us are beginner, I consider myself as beginner. Why I consider myself as beginner? And that's a very good strategy, by the way, because this industry is evolving 24/7. Every single moment, every single day, every single second, you know, there is a new update that is happening, not just from a technical perspective, but also from, you know, a legal perspective, regulatory perspective. These days, what we are seeing is, you know, the fall of, you know, centralized finance. We are seeing Vault, Celsius, Voyager, you know, all these companies, those who are giving, you know, double digit APY. So we are seeing every single day, we see a lot of things that are happening in this space. So to begin with, most of the people think that, you know, what is Web3? Is Web3 a term, you know, from where this we got this term? To be very honest, when I started my journey in 2016, there was no term called as such. You know, Web3 didn't exist at that very moment. The Web3 term actually came into existence in, say, 2021 and the later part of the 2021. Because of this NFTs and metaverses, you know, when they came in. So somewhere people started realizing that, you know, now we have DeFi, now we have DAOs, now we have, you know, various applications. Now we are progressing at a very faster pace. We have metaverses, DAO, crypto, Bitcoin, Ethereum, smart contracts, L1, L2. So much has happened in the past 6 years that now people are figuring out we need to give it a broader term. We need to give it a term that is, you know, quite classy, and it looks, you know, it looks good when you talk about Web3 rather than, you know, and also there has been a moment where, you know, crypto was seen as a negative thing in the media. So most of the people jumped onto Web3. And I think it's a good strategy because people, you know, media and majorly I've seen politicians, they think that, you know, Web3 is something that very legit, and I think that we are okay with Web3, we are okay with the decentralized internet, but not with crypto. But they forget to understand that Web3 is not possible without you know, the crypto technology. So the technology behind crypto is the essence, crypto is the integral part of Web3. So you can say that Web3 is you know, is equal to decentralized web. So if I have to summarize it in one word, so that Web3 is the right word, and I think it's getting popular day by day. And also when we see when we go in the past and we compare it with, you know, so most of the people said, okay, if you have to compare it with the earlier versions, so earlier versions were Web 1 and Web 2. So that's the reason it's easier for me to compare, you know, Web 1, Web 2, and then Web 3. Now, we also know that their Web 5 has already arrived. So I'm not getting into that. But there are talks that, you know, Web 5 is being pushed around. And now you can ask me this question, where Web 4 has gone. So I really don't know. I don't have an answer for that. But But at this very moment, what we are going to talk is talk about Web3. Now, Web3 as such is, what is happening in this in Web3? At this very moment, if you see, Web3 is growing fast. If you see most of the VCs, Sequoia, Tiger Global, biggest, A16Z, everybody is investing into, this space. And $33 billion US dollar has already been invested in 2021. $29 million US dollar is the revenue on Ethereum, right? Ethereum is a programmable blockchain, a network, where the network has a revenue model where the average revenue per day is 29 million. And it was, by the way, 10.7 billion US dollar in 2021. So it's growing very fast. OpenSea, a decentralized marketplace, NFT marketplace, has already got a volume of 14 billion US dollar in 2021. And DeFi right now, today it is 50 billion, but it was once in 2021 and early 2022, it was hovering around 250 billion US dollars. So DeFi is the decentralized finance, the financial institutions that we see, the total value locked, the money invested in these protocols is close to 250 billion US dollar all-time high. And today it is 50 billion because of the bearish market sentiments. Citibank has projected that this Web3 ecosystem will touch close to 13 trillion US dollar in 2030. So it's like 8 years ahead. 8 years and 13 trillion US dollar. Right now, the market is not even 1 trillion US dollar, but only the entire economy is going to be 13 trillion. And Goldman Sachs also says that it is going to be close to 8 trillion US dollar. So all in all, big banks and big financial institutions are projecting it to be huge. Now, what is Web1, Web2, Web3, right? So this particular image has been taken from A16Z, from their one of their report. So I want to give them a credit. So basically, Web1, Web2, and Web3. I like this image because of the sense that it actually makes it very easy. So what was Web1? So Web1 actually, I'm 80 born. So if somebody is there whose date of birth is around 85, 84, 85, can very well relate to it, that the kind of internet that we used to see during those days in 1990, there used to be a desktop and a slow internet. And the internet at that point of time, Web1, was that, the pages used to get downloaded and the best I could do was to read that information. So that's the reason it is called the read-only internet. So there were many web pages. Those were actually the photocopy of the real magazine. So they were not even innovating to an extent that they could write something else, So they were taking a photocopy of the real magazines and just putting it there. So the only option you had was only to read, during that time, and that too limited options. There were not, you could not Google at that point of time. The only option was those slow moving pages. Generally, it was used to read, some articles, some magazines, and the only thing you could do about, at that point of time was you could read some international magazine or article that was not readily accessible in say India. So that was the only thing. And because of the slow internet and because, there was no advancement in the language, how you could, design, because there was not much of an innovation that has happened or the advancement that had happened in terms of the coding language. So very limited resources. That was only a read only, web. And obviously it was way too centralized because somebody was putting in pages and that's the only option that you had, right? Second, in 2005, this is the internet. This is the era where we relate to the most, because this is the internet where most of the people have actually grown with. So, if I have to say, if I am 80 born, there are most of the people, if they must be listening to this space, are 90s born. So they can very well relate to it, that they know about Facebook, they know about, YouTube. So this is the internet where you could actually read and write. So this was an era where, language got a little advanced. You had JavaScript, Ajax, and now you could even read, then you, it was an era of social media as well, where social media companies, they came in and where you can actually write your blog, you can write comment, you can like, you can give, you can reply, you can email, you can do so many things that we know, and that's the reason during this era, since we were able to interact with the web, so those platforms where you could interact, so like Facebook, for example, or Instagram, for example, or Twitter, for example, right? So those platforms, they grew in size. And YouTube, for example, where you can post your videos. So these platforms, they grew in size. And we all know that during this era, most of the companies were very limited who took the advantage of it. And now we see that this is one of the most centralized version of the internet, that we see today. And in this era, to access the web, you had to, sacrifice your personal information as well to access, this version of the internet. And now the current version that we are seeing and the future version, and this is, by the way, not perfect. I cannot claim that this is the perfect version, because there are challenges. But going forward, with every day, passing day, this is going to be the era of Web3 in future, where you could write, where you could read, and where you can own, your content as well, your information as well. So basically, Web1 was read information. Web2 was read and write information, right? Read and write, and you could publish your information as well. And on Web3, you can read, write, and own your information as well. In Web2, you don't own your information. Somebody else, the central servers or the companies, they own that. That's the reason the next slide, if you see, in every era, as we progress, you find different kind of companies evolving in different eras. So like in Web1, you had some companies, and they evolved into Web2, but some of the companies, they finished, right? They couldn't enter into Web2. Similarly, in Web2, these are familiar logos, by the way. WhatsApp, I'm familiar. Messenger, Facebook, Insta, Google, right? You are familiar with these logos. But as we are entering into Web3, so for some people in Web1, these logos would have felt like aliens, right? They couldn't figure out, okay, in those early days when this web was evolving, we couldn't connect with these logos, that I don't know if this will work or not. So similarly, at this point of time, if you'll show these logos in your family, especially this MetaMask or Bitcoin, very many people will relate to. Ethereum, many people will relate to. But many logos, people might not even realize that, okay, I don't know if this will work or not. But by the way, things are working. We see Brave, the web browser, that many people who are not even in crypto, they even use web, Brave browser, and MetaMask, right? And OpenSea. So you see, there are a lot of applications, a lot of logos that have evolved over time, and Web1, Web2, Web3, and that's the reason the next slide gives you a very clear picture. This slide tells you that, where is your data basically. In Web1, you access your data on the server. The server controls, right? The server controls the data in Web1. In Web2, on social network, you access your data on a server. The server at the intermediary can control it. So you feel that you are in control of your data, but if intermediary can, is in control of your data, the server at the intermediary can control it. So it gives you a feeling that you are in control of your picture, you are in control of your account. But suddenly when this, on Twitter, suppose you are blocked, or on Instagram, your account is removed without informing you, then you realize, okay, I was not in control of my data, right? Or I was not in control of my account. So you are dependent upon them. In Web3, the user controls the data and their assets, right? That is the most important part. The data may continue to live on the other servers. So it might be the data might be present at the other server or the decentralized servers, but you are in control of your data and your assets. That is the power of Web3, and that is why Web3 is evolving, right? And we are familiar with these applications, by the way. If you see in Web1, every time you know, you had to access it because there were very limited application by them. So the only thing you could use was email and a password, right? So that's the only facility you had, and you had no mobile. So the only way was to do it through web, you know, browser, and with not many options at that point of time. And the only thing you could use was email and the password. And then web 2, these big giants, they became so huge that most of the applications, when you were trying to access, you had to access through, you know, Facebook's or, you know, Google or your LinkedIn or your social media account you could use. And to access web 2, they said, okay, fine. If you want to use my applications, you have to give your, you know, data. So you had to sacrifice your data. So you had to give your name, your telephone number at times, you know, your gender, your location. So they could have picked any which way. So there were many personal information they asked for before using, their applications. And in Web3, you don't have to give any your information, your personal information. You just have to connect, your wallet to the various applications, and you have various options like MetaMask, you have Trust wallets, and you can, just connect through those wallets, and you can access any applications. The application doesn't even know you're a male or a female or you're an Indian or an American or African, doesn't matter. They are least interested. And that's the beauty. And that's one thing that is being, it's not that we are hyping this thing. If you understand, these are like human natural progression. Everybody today want to take charge of their privacy. That's the reason these applications, Web3, is growing, because people want to be in control of their data and their privacy, because they know today that the data was misused and is misused at present. The data was used for not just for the advertisement, but for the political scenario. The Cambridge Analytica, in which we saw that, the data was used to even, in elections in US, and not just in US, in many countries that data was used to figure out to win elections so that was an eye opener. And that's the reason people want to be in charge of their data. So basically, present internet has some flaws, and those flaws are, it is way too centralized. Only few companies have gained. And, when I say that, just imagine 5,000 early users of Facebook's. Where are they? In fact, if you ask me, after Mark Zuckerberg, the most important people in the Facebook network are those 5,000 early believers who believed in Facebook. Probably they should have been rewarded. They should have been given some share or something to them, because those were the early believers. Where are they? Nobody knows. Nobody knows that who were those 5,000 early users of Facebook. So that is a very important part. And in that, in this overall scenario, you felt like that you're getting a free service, free Facebook, free Orkut, or free Twitter, or free Instagram. But actually, it was not free. You were giving your data, you were giving your private data to access that. And that your private data, by the way, has a cost. You go on a dark web, you go on internet, there are many sites where you will figure out that there are data exchanges. So your private data actually gets sold on every single minute. There are exchanges where your data is getting sold, in millions and billions. So obviously this is not legal, but on internet, there are marketplaces where the data gets sold. So these are like, this is a very scary scenario. That's the reason people want to be in control of the data. And Web3, the single biggest point is ownership. In Web3, you are in control of your web life. That is very important. You are in control of your web life. Right now, you want to be in control of your web life, but you don't have any choice. So that's the reason Web3 is growing, and Web3 is evolving at every single point of time. And why Web3 is growing? Simple. Because the moment you have centralized database, like centralized network, there is a single point failure. If a hacker or if you can get an access somewhere to this thing, everything is in control. All this, everything, the every single thing that is connected to the central database, if I get an access to that, I get control of everything, right? Here also, it's a decentralized network. Here also, the servers are distributed, but still if you are able to access one or two, you can still have a partial control of the network. But here it is a distributed network where every single node is independent, right? And this is the beauty of Web3. Web3 ethos is based on the distributed network or the distributed ledger technology, as we commonly hear that, right? So when I say Web3 is an umbrella term. So whenever you there are a lot of confusion that people, I have seen that people keep fighting. No, Web3 is this. In fact, everybody is right, by the way. If you say that, you know, Web3, Web3 is crypto, Web3 is DeFi, Web3 is NFT, somewhere everybody is right. If I have to give you this thing, what is Web3? Because, and this is not the only definition. So Web3 is an umbrella term that includes cypherpunk's manifesto that I'm coming. Crypto includes everything, by the way. You know, crypto includes the entire, you know, Bitcoin, Ethereum, L1, L2. So all the blockchains, right? And all the layer two solutions, everything that we talk about today comes under, you know, an umbrella term, Web3. DeFi, NFT, Metaverse, DAO. So all these terms that, and today, and even tomorrow, when you'll talk about soulbound tokens, or if you'll talk about MetaFi, or if you'll talk about anything else that gets evolved in the future, it's all under the umbrella of Web3. So Web3 is basically more of a philosophical concept, and it is powered by the crypto technology. Without crypto technology, Web3 cannot exist. So Web3 is a philosophy powered by crypto. So in a sense, Web3 is a bigger term. It's a philosophy, and philosophies are always bigger than the, you know, technology, because without a philosophy, the human brain will not find solutions. So if I have a philosophy of, say, suppose I'll come to the next term. So these are like cypherpunks. You know, many people think that the Bitcoin got evolved overnight. It's a one night wonder. Sorry. There were cypherpunks, you know, who believed that in 1970s and 65, when they saw that two computers can talk to each other, like they can connect to each other, cypherpunks at that point of time said, oh my God, there's a problem. Imagine in 1970s, they figured out there's a problem, because once now two computers can connect to each other, and when they can talk, how we will ensure that communication that is happening between two computers is going to be private. And tomorrow, when this network will grow, when it will be used by millions and millions of people around the world, how we will ensure that the communication happening between a husband and a wife, boyfriend and a girlfriend, sisters, mother, personal lives, how we will ensure that the information that is getting exchanged is private. So these were the cypherpunks who actually lived their life, dedicated their life. Nick Szabo, David Shom, the father of cryptography, Eric Hughes, Hall Finney, who was the early believer in Bitcoin after Satoshi, Eric Hughes. So these were the people who fought for privacy. You know, who fought for solutions. And by the way, encryption, SSL technology, or blind signatures, whatever today you use in your credit card or bank accounts, all because of these gentlemen. And these are the only few, because of the limitation of the slide. There were many who died, who sacrificed their life without even, we don't even know them. And Satoshi is one of them, by the way. We don't know who is Satoshi. And we don't know he is dead or alive. But what he has given is an amazing solution for the humanity. And that is what their people have dedicated. This is a philosophy. Now, philosophy is bigger than technology. Always remember. Technology cannot be bigger than philosophy. Philosophy is always bigger than technology. Right? So this was the crypto cypherpunk manifesto. I will just read the first two lines. Privacy is necessary for an open society in the electronic age. Privacy is not secrecy. So there's a difference between privacy and secrecy. A private matter is something one doesn't want the whole world to know. But a secret matter is something one doesn't want anybody to know. Privacy is the power to selectively reveal oneself to the world. Just imagine. So this was the cypherpunk manifesto. It's like a Bible. So this one pager is the manifesto where even today, all the cypherpunks, they believe in, right? So this cypherpunk is not about hiding something. It's about my selective choice of revealing myself, you know, to the world. You know, you have curtains in the room. Why you have curtains in the room? Because you want your private matters to be private and you don't want your neighbors to see what is happening inside the room. So you take curtains. Now, curtains is a privacy, right? It is not secrecy. You're not doing anything wrong. So that is how the cypherpunks believed in it. And that's the reason many people see that I continue to hear that, you know, Bitcoin is a one night wonder and it's a Ponzi and all that stuff. I keep hearing and I say, thank you. But many people, they don't know. There were many attempts in the past. From eCash to Mojo Nation to Hashcash to eGold to BMoney to BitGold. You know, these were all experiments that has happened in the past before Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is not a one-night wonder. It is basically an outcome of all the attempts that were done in the past, right? And the first milestone in Web3 is Bitcoin. So if anybody says that Web3 is something else, Bitcoin is something else, no, they're utterly wrong. Because, you know, how can you build a building without pillars? You cannot. You have to have a strong foundation for the building to rise. You know, you need to have a good steel, right, at the bottom, you know, so that you can take that building to the maximum height or the number of floors that you want to achieve, right? So the first milestone in Web3 is Bitcoin. So basically, Bitcoin is a software. So there are many definitions for Bitcoin. And by the way, everybody's right. So if somebody says digital currency, somebody says digital token, somebody says something else, it's perfectly fine because philosophies are never static. Bitcoin is a philosophy. It's more of a philosophical this thing. So if for me, Bitcoin is this, for you, Bitcoin is something else, that's perfectly okay. Never ever criticize anybody for his definition and version of Bitcoin. So for me, Bitcoin is a software. You can download it and run it on your computer. It is as simple as that, right? A software. And now what is a software? Software has a work. Software has some rules to define. You know, software, there are things that are, you know, defined in the software that it is designed to perform some job. Simple. Software are designed to perform some job. So a Bitcoin software is designed to run a decentralized payment network. Simple. You know, you have centralized payment networks like Visas and Masters. Bitcoin is a software that is designed to run a decentralized payment network. Simple. And this software, you can download it on your computer, you can run it yourself. And there are participants, there are people who run this network, and the job of everybody is well defined. And that is what brings consensus in the network. So it's like a Bible. It's like a truth that everybody believes in it. That's why some people, if you ask me, they say Bitcoin is a religion. And by the way, they're right. Somebody says Bitcoin is a living organism. At any single point of time, Bitcoin is alive. It keeps evolving. There are people who are working on it. It's breathing. It is taking energy from sun, from wind. So it's like an organism who takes, you know, the energy from natural resources. Even they are right. So that's the reason I say Bitcoin has many definitions, but at this very moment, just for your understanding, Bitcoin is the base for Web3. It gives few things that turned out to be the base for Web3. So the network is purely decentralized, as we all know. So Bitcoin is basically an incentive for the people who lend their computer resources. So when ek network ko chalane ke liye, so to run a network, there are people who are giving their computing power to it. And what is the motivation behind running a decentralized payment network? Like in case of Visa and Master, there is a incentive. What is the incentive? There is that cut. When somebody makes payment, there is some commission cut that goes to the Visa and Master. And through that, Visa and Master pays to their employees, and they take care of their fixed cost and everything. Similarly, in a decentralized network, if I am giving my resources, what is the incentive? There has to be a motivation to run a decentralized payment network. And that incentive is Bitcoin. Simple. If there wouldn't have been any incentive, why somebody would have gone and joined the network? So Bitcoin is both a payment and a payment network like Visa and Master, right? And Bitcoin solved the most important problem that was not solved before the invention of Bitcoin, and that was the solution to double spending. So we'll run through this. I know many of you knows all these things. I mean, you must be, but every time when you listen to all these sessions, there are some angles that you say, oh wow, I liked this explanation. I also know so many things, but whenever I get an opportunity, I join these sessions because I get something new out of it. Like, this is a simple description where, you know, you have fiat currency and Bitcoin. In fiat currency, you have these banks, you know, you send your money to your bank, the bank, you know, contacts a payment network like Visa, Master, Western Union, and then they transfer it to your bank. And, you know, so there are a lot of intermediary middlemen in between who take their cut just to transfer one monetary value to another, you know, person. So earlier, you know, the cash has a very important aspect. So, you know, if you, there were only two ways of sending money to anybody. So one was sending cash. So if you have to send money to US to somebody, so suppose you want to send $10,000. So the one way was to take cash, go to US, take a flight and deliver it yourself. That was the most safest and the safest way of delivering it. The other was to trust somebody. And that trust was eventually, you know, the Visas and MasterCards and Western Union are nothing but these intermediaries are like the trusted organization. That, okay, they'll ensure that your money goes there, right? So that's the reason they have become so huge in size. Bitcoin said, okay, you two people can send money, send a monetary value to each other without trusting any third party. So it is also known as peer-to-peer. You know, so one person to another person without relying on any third party. So, but obviously the exchange is happening. So how this is happening, that we'll discuss further. So basically in any network, you know, there are nodes, and how this network is getting, who is managing this network is very important. So basically in a Bitcoin network, you have nodes and every node has got a copy of the ledger, right? And every node has got the same copy of the ledger, and you know, they are updating it. Imagine the beauty of this thing is that, you know, everybody has a consensus among them. So they, you know, they follow the same rule, they follow the same thought process, and they follow the same rules to, you know, manage the network and update the network. Imagine if node B would have been working independently and updating their ledger, you know, node A was updating their own ledger, and node C was updating their own ledger. If every node would have been updating their own ledger, you could imagine, you know, the consensus wouldn't have achieved and the network would have failed, right? If every ledger was updating their, every node was updating their own ledger. The beauty of, you know, the Bitcoin network is that every node, you know, has got a copy of the ledger, and, you know, they're having the same copy. And the best part about it is that nodes are keeping a check on the network that everything is going fine, right? The miners are mining the block in the right way. There is no, you know, malfunctioning. There is no, there is no alien factor or somebody is not trying to, you know, manipulate the network. So nodes are basically a gatekeepers also. And they, every node doesn't have to know each other. And that's the beauty of a distributed ledger. And this thing is achieved through consensus mechanism. And consensus mechanism is basically, you know, in a centralized system, it is very easy to bring everybody to a consensus. In our own life, it is very difficult to bring 10 friends to one consensus to watch a movie. Nobody will agree to watch one. You'll give an option, but 10 friends will have 10 different options to watch a movie. So consensus in a centralized network is very easy. But in a decentralized network, it is very difficult. And that's the beauty. And Bitcoin, for the first time, you know, bought this consensus mechanism in a decentralized network, because there is no boss, right? But in a centralized network, it is very easy to bring consensus, because you have to agree with it. If you don't agree with it, you will be thrown out of the organization, right? So that's the reason, you know, I think that slide is, yeah. So that slide is So I'll come on to that slide in the next. So consensus mechanism basically binds the network together, right? So it's like the single source of truth that everybody, you know, believes in. Okay, we believe in these rules, and these rules are not defined by any boss, right? So there are various types of consensus mechanism in the past. So proof of work, proof of stakes. And as the industry is evolving today, you have delayed proof of work, you have least proof of stake and proof of authority. And these all, the goal of all consensus mechanism is to bring the consensus in a decentralized way. Consensus, again, that everybody who is there in the network should be aligned to that rule, should have one goal, and should follow those rules that has been defined, right? So these are the various consensus mechanisms, but the most popular one is the proof of work. And now proof of stake is also, you know, growing because of the energy, the energy criticism that proof of work gets. So many L1s are already proof of stake, and the existing Ethereum is also going on a proof of stake. That is a separate discussion, but these two are the most popular and the leader, the most, even today, Bitcoin and Ethereum, they actually work on proof of work, right? So basically proof of work is not a new technology. So it existed before, before Bitcoin was invented. And they were trying to use it in the email so that the spam doesn't happen, but it didn't work out. Even today, you see a lot of spams in your email box. But this technology was actually, meant, it was applied in early days before Bitcoin to figure out how to stop spam in email, right? Satoshi used it, in the network to avoid, the double spend. The problem of double spend. Now, what is the problem of double spending? It is very important to understand. Double spending is that you're not able to spend your money twice. So suppose if you go to a coffee shop and you pay a $10 bill to buy a coffee, and you've taken your consumed your coffee. Now you cannot come back after 1 hour and ask that cashier to give you $10 back. Why he will give you? You've spent it once. But what happens in a digital world, double spending in a digital cash system where the same funds can be, spent twice, because at the end of the day, digital money is just a data, right? And the biggest challenge is to prevent people from copying and spending the same units in different places. So this digital money, so how you will ensure that this digital money that is at the end of the day, just a data, right? Digital data that can be copied and multiple copies can be created and it can be spent, to multiple times to multiple people at multiple different places. How to ensure that? Now, in a centralized system, it is very easy. Why? So suppose here you see Bob is trying to spend, the digital coin to the same digital coin to Lisa and to other person as well, right? So one coin is trying to spend to two people. So in a centralized version, you have banks that their job is, centralized authority has got a central ledger. They ensure they do the debit and credit work. They ensure that Bob is not able to spend his money twice. And now when the central authority is the single, source, single authority to manage this, obviously it is prone to attacks, prone to manipulation, prone to hacks, right? But obviously when there is no other solution, this is the only best solution. And Bob is only able to spend his money once. And that who ensures is the financial institutions ensures it. But in a blockchain, what happens that, when a block is mined, what is block? Basically, in a blockchain, the block is basically, a lot of people have many definitions for blockchain, but blockchain is basically chain of blocks. They are placed in a chronological level, right? So block number one, block number two, block number three, and every block, contains some data, right? So what happens is that, in a consensus mechanism in a blockchain, the blocks needed to be mined by the miner, right? And the blocks needed to be placed you know, in a chronological manner, right? So who does that? There has to be somebody who puts these block in a chain. So the job that is performed, this job is performed by the miner, right? Miner, adds the block in the blockchain. Now, what is a block? So block basically contains lot of things that I'll cover it later, but the transaction, right? The transaction, if A is spending their money to, is sending their money to B, that transaction gets recorded on this block, right? Now the moment this block is added to the blockchain, right? The miner has to perform some work, right? Before adding it, because to add a block in the blockchain, miners get incentivized. How? They get Bitcoin in return. So there is a competition. So if a miner adds a block in the blockchain, he gets rewarded with a Bitcoin. And the moment this block is added to a blockchain, right? So after 6 confirmation, after 1, 2, 3, 4, so the more confirmations you have, so the more surety that the block has been successfully mined, right? So once the block has been added to the blockchain and the miner propagates, he announces that he has mined the block, all the nodes, who are the gatekeepers, who they check that this miner claim is right or not. You know, if he is trying to add this block, into this chain, has he achieved all the parameters? Has he done his work? So what is the proof that his claim is right? So the nodes, they check that, okay, the transactions are legit. The miner has performed his proof, his work, his side of the work. And the work that he has performed is within the parameters that is acceptable to the network. So it has followed all the rules. And the moment it happens, the blocks get added. And when the block gets added to a blockchain, the data gets permanently written in that block, and that is immutable. Blocks are immutable. So now you can say, what is the chances? Still, there has to be some chance. Yes, the only way forward is if somebody has to change the data in the block, he has to acquire the total, 50, so now proof of work energy is spent, hash rate is spent. So the hacker has to acquire 51% of the hash rate to basically change the data in the block, right? And to manipulate the data, so to do a legit work, you have to spend energy. You have to spend energy. You have to generate hash rate to do a legit work, and to do a illegit work. So if a hacker has an intention of doing a illegit intention or a illegit work, even then he has to spend a lot of money. So that is how the blockchain gets, its strength from. And that is the reason, if you see in this slide, I've covered what is the content of the block. So, in the next slide, you'll give a, and every block, by the way, has a unique ID. You have Aadhaar number, which is unique. So every block has got a unique ID and a unique, it's like a fingerprint, right? So what happens that every block is connected to each other. Blocks in this case, like if you see the block number 2 has a previous hash, and this block number 3 also has a previous hash, right? So what happens that if somebody, tries to manipulate the data in this particular block, so what happens that the moment you change some transaction or manipulate something, the hash gets changed. What is hash? In the previous slide, I told you this unique ID gets changed. The moment it gets changed, the next block has had the previous hash of this block. If you see 6BQ1, this is just an example I'm showing. So the moment, every single node in the network, the entire network will come to know that some change has happened, some manipulation has happened, in this thing, and everybody will get an alert. So that is how, so if you see what kind of manipulation, if you see, I have written GrowthSchool. So this is the algorithm that is used, that is SHA-256. That is how. So this is a very in-depth topic, and that will take a lot of time. And so, just for a basic understanding, how hashes are generated is basically you put in some input and you get some output. If you see, I wrote Growth School, and you got this hash that got generated, and here I just used a capital G, and the entire hash rate got changed. So the moment you put in, you do some change in the block, the entire hash gets changed, and the entire network gets an alert. So that is, and finding. So basically, proof of work is basically, this hash that you get, you generate, that is except the, because since there is a competition to among the miners to add a block in the blockchain, so this has to be, this process has to be democratized, right? So democracy has to happen in here, right? Everybody has to get a fair chance. So now, when everybody has to have a fair chance, so everybody fights for finding that hash that is acceptable to the network, right? And that is the reason, it is as good as finding a lottery number. So if you give me a there is a lottery book that is lying, or a lottery system, how can I know that this is the number that is, that will come, this is the winning number? So it's like finding the winning number in a lottery. And it seems easy when I say, but in a Bitcoin network, finding that number, finding that number that satisfies the parameters of the network is like finding an atom in the universe, or finding a needle in the sugarcane field, right? It is that difficult to find that number, right? So that is the reason, once the block has been mined, proof of work has happened, hash, the miner work is checked by the nodes, and that is how consensus is achieved. Now, why I have given so much of an effort into this is because without having an understanding of how, network works, what is consensus, what is proof of work, how a network runs in a trustless manner, in a decentralized way, that is the power from where Web3 gets its power. So Bitcoin actually gave us decentralized money, decentralization. Bitcoin told us how to decentralize incentive money. Bitcoin gave us what is decentralized. Bitcoin gave us immutability, that the blocks cannot be the data in the blocks cannot be changed. They are immutable, and if somebody has to change those blocks, has to spend 51% of the total energy of the total 51% of the total hash rate or hash power of the network. So even to do an illegitimate work on the blockchain, for a legit work you have to spend energy, you have to generate hash power, and even for illegitimate work you have to follow the same process. And now, if you will spend your resources, your money, your power, your capital for an illegitimate work, suddenly you'll realize that it is more profitable for me to use this power to mine Bitcoin rather than spending my time and energy and capital on changing the information in the block. So that is how people get incentivized to do the legit work here. Censorship resistance, you cannot censor Bitcoin. People have tried in the past, nations have tried, but they have failed. And consensus mechanism, and this consensus mechanism motivated future that many people came up with their own consensus mechanism. And that's the reason Ethereum gave us first programmable blockchain. So on Ethereum you could actually write smart contracts. Now, what are smart contracts? Smart contracts are an application or program that runs on a blockchain. So it's like, when you go to a bank, and you take a loan, so you enter into an agreement. So when you enter into an agreement, there are some conditions that if you will not pay this loan, we will do this. If you default by this date, this will be the charges, right? So you enter into an agreement. So these are the paper agreements that you sign. Right. So just imagine all these agreements, if they get automatically executed on internet, suppose on so you get an all these agreements that can be automatically executed if a particular conditions meets out, the outcome is this. If this happens, that will happen. So you could actually write these smart contracts on the blockchain, and these smart contracts get stored in the blockchain, right? So now we know that one, the blockchain is Bitcoin gave us immutability, right? So immutability, from there we got this idea, okay, if smart contracts can be stored on the blockchain and anybody can see it, and it's openly verifiable, everybody can see it, everybody can see the agreements transparently. So from there, a new era of blockchain started, and Ethereum paved the way, where a lot of applications were they were built on Ethereum, and decentralized applications started building on Ethereum, and the smart contract played the very important role there, right? And that's the reason these decentralized applications are basically the applications that you see today are centralized. Like so suppose if I have Apple Store or if I have Android and I have various applications in those operating systems, right? So they are way too centralized, right? They are so anybody can remove it, and I am dependent on the on that operating system, on Apple and Google, but on decentralized application, there is no single authority that that runs the application. Many applications are run by the user or run by the people, and the applications, they run on the blockchain network, and we all know open blockchains get their power from their decentralization, from from their immutability, from censorship resistance. So these applications cannot be removed, cannot be blocked, they derive their power from the blockchain. So these applications are powered by blockchains, right? You can explain it in it's easier for your understanding, that the same application that you see on Android, Google's, Uber's and all that, the future of all the applications are being built on, Ethereum, which is also considered to be an operating system of the future, where all these applications are being built on these things, and they derive their power from open blockchain. And the all those, USP, unique selling propositions of the blockchain gets embedded in these applications. So that's the power. So anybody can participate, anybody can use it. Users are generally owners in it, and if any app changes has to happen in application, there is a process of governance token that I'll cover later. So if you look at Web3, there are three ways to look at Web3. One is technology, another is concept, and third is use case, right? So if you see what is the integral technology used in Web3. So Web3 is a combination of technology and concepts, as I told you, philosophy and technology. So let's understand what drives Web3 technology. So in a Web3 technology, the most important part is wallets. So without a wallet, you cannot interact directly with the blockchain networks, right? So you need to have a wallet, where you MetaMask, Trust Wallet, there are various wallets that you can use, these are integral part to access Web3. So they are basically wallets, can also be termed as your identity also. So you have ENS domains. Today ENS domain, if I have kashif.eth.eth, so it's a domain name. So this domain, if I own it, this is my identity also, right? So wallets are also kind of an identity. They play a role of your identity management as well. So wallets are basically required to interact with the blockchain. It's a gateway, it's the key. So email ID to access Facebook was the key in Web2, or Facebook login was the key to access an application. Wallet is a key to access blockchain. So you have tokens. Tokens are basically a digital representation of value or an asset stored on a blockchain. So token can be fungible or token can be non-fungible. Token can be backed by USD, like stable coins, or token can be Ethereum, which is a utility token, right? So which is used for paying the gas fees on Ethereum network. Then you have smart contracts. Without smart contracts, Web3 wouldn't have existed. So wallets, tokens, smart contract, very integral part. Smart contracts are automatically executable agreements. all those agreements that happen in the present world can be automatically executed going forward on blockchain. And if some conditions meet out, say suppose tomorrow somebody can write this thing that if Akshay has 3 Ethereum, and if Akshay, on Akshay's 60th birthday, so suppose on this date, the moment Akshay gets 60 years old, these 3 Ethereum should be sent to 3 addresses. And those 3 addresses are his 3 children. So you can write these kind of applications on blockchain. So you can plan your inheritance as well. So the moment that date and time arrives, those 3 tokens will travel to the respective addresses. So those kind of complex, those kind of easy, those kind of complex, you can write complex agreements as well, like, APYs and DeFi, we see very, very complex kind of agreements can also be executed. And blockchain network. So Web3 technology cannot survive, is not possible without wallet, without token, without smart contract, and without a blockchain network. And concepts. Web3 concepts is basically philosophies of Web3 is ownership, that user has to have a control over their assets, data, and content. Programmability. So in Web3, the beauty is that your tokens are programmable. So like in case of NFTs, you can write a program within the token that the moment this picture sells, the creator gets a 5% commission every time this picture sells. Now picture is basically a token, right? So non-fungible token, it's an NFT. So every time throughout the lifetime or throughout the history of blockchain, whenever till eternity, whenever this picture will get sold, 5% will be sent to this particular address. So those kind of programmability you can write on. So that is the core of Web3: ownership, programmability, and composability. For me, the best part I like about Web3 is composability. I like everything, but composability is something that I really feel. So composability is that you found wheels. You invented wheels. Somebody came. Let me make a cart. So he made a wooden cart and he placed it on the wheel. Now it's a movable cart. Now somebody came in. Let me bring a bull. And he attached that bull or a horse to that cart. Now it was a bull cart. Okay. Now this thing can move. Okay. He said the other person came. Let me build a movable, restaurant over it or a milk bar over it. Just an example. He said, okay. So somebody invented wheel, somebody invented cart, somebody invented something else, somebody invented something else. So what I'm just trying to say, in Web3, invention has to happen once. So Uniswap was an invention. So it happened once. Now, you know the code, you know the open source code, you can build over Uniswap now. You can just copy paste the entire code and you can add changes to it, right? Are you getting me? You know what is already existing. You know the code. You take the code, or even if you don't want to take the code, you want to integrate with that. You can still integrate with that. You don't need anybody's permission, by the way. That is the beauty of composability. That is why this Web3 is growing fast. Earlier, Web2 companies were not giving their code, their innovations, their patents, the problem of patents. They were hiding. They didn't want anybody to use this thing. They were hiding. They were reluctant. In Web3, everything is open. That's the beauty of Web3. Decentralization. The lack of central authority making data, software, and asset portable. So it's like a permissionless free internet. It's Web3. So your data, your software, your platform, anybody can move from. So different metaverses. If I am on Ethereum, you have bridges. I want to go to somebody else. I have an avatar. I am in a metaverse of Ethereum. Tomorrow I want to go in the metaverse of Solana. I can freely, easily go there. Use case of Web3. In Web3, you'll have different use cases. The the most important of all is stable coins. So we saw algorithmic stable coins, and by the way, Luna was a fallout. Everybody knows about it, but that was just an experiment, and many such experiments will happen. DAI is a successful experiment, by the way. MakerDAO is a very successful experiment where you have a successful decentralized stable coin. Then Web3 will be used for issuing stable coins, decentralized stable coins. Then you have DeFi, the decentralized finance, various applications, lending, borrowing platforms are already being built. You have Aave, you have Compound, I said $250 billion US dollar worth of total value locked was there in 2021. Now at present it is 50 billion. So many applications are being built in this space. NFTs, we all know it's a non-fungible tokens. So basically it's like, just to touch upon this for a little extra, it's like, imagine, you draw a picture, or you took a picture, right? You went to a holiday in Missouri and you took a very nice picture and you posted on your Facebook. I liked it. And one of your friend, I liked it. I just had to download it and put it back to my, Facebook profile, and everybody's liking it. Oh my God. I said, but this picture was taken by me. And you started fighting, and by the way, these things are very common in Web2. And people, they just have to right click, save it, and then use it on your platform. And you cannot prove your ownership. NFTs are the most revolutionary thing that has happened to us, to be very honest. And by the way, the masses, the companies, the various organizations are entering into this space. NFTs has opened a gateway to the world. This is because this is one of the most important use cases in Web3. Why? Because now you can prove your ownership of your digital assets. This was not possible earlier. So now you can prove your ownership of your digital assets. And when the moment you can prove your ownership, now the world has opened. The possibilities are endless. The music industry, movie industry, IP rights, your property deeds, your merchandising, your NFT stores, every brand, fashion brand is coming into NFTs, and we're already seeing a lot of announcements that are happening already in this place. That's the reason, because 70% of the time people are spending on internet, and when so much time is being spent here, the economies of scales is happening here. The economy is getting generated on internet, and when so much is happening on internet, people are most of the time on internet, on screen. The people can now own their digital assets, and they can own it, and anybody can openly verify it. If I own a Bored Ape yacht, anybody can openly verify it. That's the beauty. So the whole new possibilities have opened after NFTs, and then you have DAOs. DAOs is like the decentralized autonomous organization where the whole new relationship, has been established. But so it's basically now employees used to work for an organization for a boss. There was a boss who used to say, do this, do this, do this, do this, do this, and take a salary and get lost. Oh no, sorry, get lost. With all due respect, I was into 16 years into job, but I know that there was not much of an innovation. There was like most of the time I was into boss management. I'll be very honest. What should I do to him? That he should be happy. My appraisal is here with him. I don't know what he will do with my appraisal. What kind of questions he's going to ask in my appraisal? That is that level of stress. Now there are these new set of organizations that are coming. They're saying, okay, join us, work for us. You're not an employee. You are a contributor. If this thing works well, you get tokens. And if this thing works really well, the kind of time you're contributing to it. You want to give 30 minutes, give 30 minutes. You want to give half an hour, you give half an hour. You want to dedicate your life, dedicate it. You have your share of tokens. And the moment this organization does well, you also grow. So it's like, imagine Facebook would have been a DAO, and he would have given the 10,000 early believers in Facebook, the Facebook tokens, FB tokens. And imagine today, if FB has risen to a 2 billion active user on a daily basis, imagine the kind of value of those tokens would have been, right? By the way, the value of share prices, you know, already is very high of Facebook, but imagine the token holders of that time would have gone to, you know, so that's the reason like Uniswap did it. So in a future organization, people will be incentivized to work for those organizations as a contributor for an entity, and they get tokens in return, and that those tokens would be much, much bigger than the salaries they can drive from the previous organization. Facilitating value transfers, it's like you can transfer value to one place to another. In Web3, you have transparency. You have firms like Chainalysis. You have firms like Messari, you know, who are doing on-chain analysis of data. So this is again a Web3, you know, use case. And then you have metaverses. So in metaverse, when so much of you know, people, there will be a time where people, when they're spending so much time on the internet, they like to experience things, you know, virtually. So these virtual worlds, you know, the 3D worlds are being built in the metaverses, and where people can actually go and experience. When I say experience, they can buy stuff, they can interact with stuff, they can spend time, they can buy something. And when they buy something, that thing they own. So the virtual world, the Roblox that you have, or a game that you play on a mobile, looks like a metaverse, but it's actually a centralized metaverse. The Meta Facebook claims is a central metaverse, that the rules are defined by Facebook for that. He can take away your, Facebook can take away your digital assets that you buy in Facebook. Those are being stored on the Facebook server. But the metaverse that are being built on the open blockchains, not on Bitcoin, Ethereum, Solana, or some other blockchain, there on those metaverses, the assets that you own are in your control. And you own your identity, you own your assets. And the high chances are that the metaverses built on open blockchain will survive more. And then you have decentralized applications. How decentralized applications are going to transform is that now when you know that blockchains are immutable, now when you know that blockchains are decentralized. So when I say decentralized, there is a blockchain trilemma. So that's the reason Web3 is struggling. You know, Web3, polygons and these layer two solutions, what they're trying to do is they're trying to scale, you know, the shortcomings of the base layers like L1, the Bitcoins and Ethereums. You know, they're trying to scale it up to the speed, the gas fees that was being used. So various applications are being built on these layer twos and layer one as well. And these applications, they derive their power from the open blockchain. You have your applications even today in your mobile phones. You have applications, you are using it, but you know that these applications are central applications. And obviously to use those applications, you are giving your lot of data. And have you ever noticed when you use an application on your mobile phone, it asks for so many rights. I want to use your gallery. I want to use your contacts. If you are not allowing me, I'm not going to give you the right to use me. But in decentralized applications, you just need a wallet to access these applications. And these applications, they derive their power from blockchain. And going forward, there is a concept of governance as well, where these applications, they continue to issue governance tokens to their, users, where if they want to have a certain change in the application, so that application needs to be voted. So that voting power comes from the governance tokens. So that is how a governance structure can also be built in the Web3. And always remember that Web3 is bigger than crypto, and crypto technology unlock the Web3 potential. So Web3 is a philosophy. Crypto is the power behind that. It powers that philosophy through technology. Thank you.
Perfect. That was a wonderful session. Thank you, Kashif, for doing that with all of us. I think we got a lot of sense, also in a lot of simplified terms, the comments. I was following some comments and people were saying, you know, it's very well simplified. And now we get a lot of things that we were learning before. Let's quickly take some questions that we have.
Yeah.
Perfect. So one question that came around was how exactly consensus mechanism works. You already covered it in one of the slides, but just to take, let's say, some example, if you can make a reference of it.
How consensus mechanism works. So it's a long topic, but I'll try to explain it. So basically, consensus mechanism that, on the blockchain, nobody knows any, because on a blockchain, people are voluntarily joining the network. On a Bitcoin network, there are close to lakhs, so if you go on the website, you'll see at present right now, there'll be close to 13 to 15,000 nodes. But, if there are a lot of people who use VPNs to be the node, so if you total that, there'll be close to more than 50,000 to 1 lakh nodes at present when we are talking. So at any given point of time, people are working, people are voluntarily, they've joined the network and they don't know each other. They don't trust each other and they don't have to. Now, how to bring all these people to one mission? How to bring all these people to one goal or to one rule book? In an organization, in a central organization, it is very easy. You have this HR says, do this, come on time. We are formals in meeting. Boss is coming tomorrow. You can't leave. So you have those rules. Otherwise, you will be chucked out. So people have to follow the rules by hook or by crook. But in a decentralized network where nobody is boss, everybody is voluntarily doing their work, how to follow that rule? So consensus mechanism had to be there. And what is consensus? So in a decentralized network, consensus is achieved through consensus mechanism. So in a Bitcoin network, it is called proof of work. So proof of work is basically that if you are adding, if you're adding a block in a blockchain, right? Now, block is basically constitutes the transactions that has happened. So if I am sending some money to Om or Shashank, so that is getting recorded on the block, right? And once that block, once that transaction gets recorded, so if I am sending money to Shashank, my account has to be debited. So Bitcoin will move out of my account and Shashank account will get credited, right? Now that will be recorded on the block. Right. Now, to ensure that I don't spend that money once again. Right. So that has to be recorded and I should not be able to spend it twice. So this job is performed by miners. What he does, he blocks a mine. He mines a block. He takes all these transactions, put it in a block, and he announces that he has mined the block and he has added this block in the blockchain. Please reward me with the Bitcoin. So he doesn't have to request basically. He just says, I have done it. Check it. Node says, okay, this check the claim of this guy. So when they check the claim, there is some work this miner has to perform. So one of the job is that he has to find that random number, that lottery ticket, the number of that lottery ticket. Now that random number, it comes through a mathematical puzzle, a very complex puzzle. For that, you need computers, hardware, specialized hardware to calculate that. And so there is a competition. So once the miner performs that job, because it has to be democratized, everybody has to have a fair chance. So the moment somebody wins that, finds that number, says, okay, I've got it. Node says, okay, this guy got it. Reward him. So this is all like automatic. This consensus happens automatically. So the moment somebody claims it, node says, okay, this guy has performed his job. The miner gets his reward and the block gets added into the blockchain. And once the block gets added to the blockchain and after 5-6 confirmations, you cannot change the content of that block. So once I have spent my money to Shashank, I cannot spend the same Bitcoin to give it to Abhishek or Anil. It has been recorded. So that is the power of this consensus to run the network without trusting each other is the power of, Bitcoin network. And that is what makes Bitcoin special. This consensus mechanism.
Got it. With the question which has a long, I guess, explanation, that is, what exactly is censorship resistant? One thing again that you mentioned throughout the presentation. Again, any such example that you can take, probably that would be easy for us.
Censorship resistance is basically, I want to Priyansh or Anil is my brother, and he is in US. And Anil says, Kashif bhai, I need money. I am not well out here. I just need money. Please send me some money. So I said, okay, I'm coming. Just wait. So what I did, I took my $5,000. I went to bank and I said, you know, I want this money to be sent to Anil. My brother is in US and he needs money. Bank said, okay, Anil takes that money from me. And he realizes that I have not updated my KYC and Aadhaar card and all that, right? So the bank, you know, despite my money, is not sending my money, you know? So it's basically my own money has been censored. So I cannot spend that money, despite that my brother needs it, right? So these intermediaries had so much of power that they can censor you. They can throw you out of the network. Now, tomorrow, imagine if everybody gets digital. They say there will be a time when there will be no cash. You know, if somebody is thrown out of the system, how he will be able to access that monetary system? That's the reason we say banking system is required. You know, there are people who doesn't have a banking facility. How they will be included into the financial system, right? So when you can censor this thing, so in a Bitcoin network, nothing can be censored. Not just in terms of you can spend your, you know, Bitcoin, or you can spend your crypto without, you know, fearing that that money will be censored or even that applies for miners also. Nobody can throw a miner, you know, who's doing a legit work, and nobody can throw a node who's doing a legit work. So you can join the network at will, you can leave the network at will, you can join the mine as miner at will, you can come out of that network at your will, you can send the money at will, you can receive the money at will, nobody can censor you. And we saw it in China when China said nobody can mine from China, but mining continued to happen at other places. So censorship is not applicable on a decentralized network like Bitcoin.
Got it. Thank you so much for that. That's very simplified. One thing, you know, that you mentioned, double spending, you know, that is something that blockchain technology takes care of. But at the same point, how is plagiarism taken care of? You know, if I have, let's say, minted an NFT or kept some document on my blockchain, and definitely someone can actually copy that document and mint it on, let's say, some other blockchain or the same one. Definitely we can identify, okay, with the timestamp that who kept it first. But is there something where we can take care of these plagiarism problem that's happening, or thoughts around that?
Yeah, so I think you have touched upon a very good problem that the industry is facing right now in NFT space. So, you know, what will happen as the industry is evolving, and there have been cases where crypto punks, so there were with different names, all these different kind of punks, they evolved, right? So somebody was, if a punk was looking at left, somebody, you know, made the same punks with, and the punk was looking at right. So there was this case that is still being fought, where people, tried to. So these issues are there. In fact, in apes also, we are seeing hundreds and thousands of different apes that are. The main thing that you need to, understand here, the digital assets that are evolving with time are, most of the assets are being driven by community. So you can still, say that, okay, I got an inspiration from Bored Ape Yacht and I created this, but from where you will get that community to push that? So you might still be able to, copy to the maximum, right? And it might look same, and you might even get some supporters also. But the community that the original artwork or original creator gets cannot be copied. And that's the beauty of Web3. So even, Bitcoin has hard forks. Ethereum, has forks, and they also have supporters. You have LTC supporters, Litecoin supporters. You have Bitcoin SV supporters. You have Bitcoin Cash supporters. But you have Bitcoin supporters as well who are driving it. They are much higher in numbers of the people who have copied that source. So that is very important. And with time, in NFT space especially, you will see law evolving with time. there are going to be smart contracts who will, you know, define these things in advance there, because legal is also evolving with time. Intellectual property rights will also evolve. Law will also evolve with time, where this can be fought on chain. These kind of issues can be fought on chain, where if something is proven on chain, the decentralized NFT marketplace will take off, you know, that asset on chain.
Got it. And I think just adding a little bit on that, I think this is one of the recent examples that we have saw also, where one of the community's artists that we have, his art was copied and put down on Rarible by one of the different artists. And when all of our community members, let's say 50 people, reached out to Rarible and they were able to justify, oh, this is the original creator, they took down his account. And I think at this point of time, platforms are playing a good role in this. And I think, as you mentioned, legal will take a good stand moving forward in terms of smart contracts and that. One last thing, I think, you know, this is in reference to the very recent tweet Jack Dorsey made, Web 5.0. Any thoughts, any top of the mind concept that you have on that?
So basically, I think Jack Dorsey is working on the identity side of it, right? And Jack Dorsey, why he has kept it as Web 5 is because you know, he has categorically said that it won't have any token, right? It won't be tokenized, right? So Jack Dorsey believes that there are already many good decentralized applications that are prevailing in the industry, especially in Web 2. So he want to leverage that, where he can leverage decentralization without tokenizing it, right? He thinks that it is possible, and he believes that for every decentralization step, or for a decentralized web, we don't need token at every step, right? That's what he believes. So he thinks that there are already technologies presently available who are doing a great job in decentralizing the already prevailing internet. So he wants to leverage that. Plus, he wants to leverage the immutability of Bitcoin. Right? That the most important aspect of Bitcoin is that is immutable. So the identity is something that should be immutable. If Kashif Raza is an identity, it should be immutable. Nobody should be able to copy it. Nobody should be able to destroy it. And nobody should be, you know, it should be very unique and strong. And multiple copies of Kashif should not be created, right? So that my record will be driven by a Bitcoin network, right? So I'll get that immutability from Bitcoin, and the decentralization, not from Web3, but from the existing decentralized technology. So you want to work on a DID, so you want to work on a decentralized identities going forward. That is what my understanding of his Web5.
Got it. And I think one last thing, you know, that I wanted you to touch upon is, as a beginner, when I'm jumping onto Web3, I get overwhelmed with a lot of stuff that's going on. How should I look at it? And what should be my path towards understanding or transitioning towards any of these, you know, domains?
Yeah, it's a very good question. So there are many people listening to me who must be from a non-technical background, and then there are from a technical background, right? For a technical background, there are lot of opportunities. I think for a technical background, if you know, I think the most demanded, if you learn various languages or the technical aspects of the blockchain, because since I'm not a technical, but I will definitely comment on the non-technical side, and I'll give people the career options available. But on a technical side, so there is no limit at present. If you can just upgrade your knowledge, if you can just upgrade your skills, if you can just upgrade your learning, and there, by the way, there are many platforms, you will be absorbed in this space. There is a high demand of right talent in this space, you know. And even if you're not talented, people still want you, and they'll groom you, and they'll really help you in that thing. Now, for a non-technical, many people think that Web3 is a technical thing and only the career options available here are for technical. For non-technical, there are so many options. I'll give you. One is that, you know, you can be a content creator here. You can write blogs. you can write, you can make your own YouTube channel. You can be an Instagram influencer. You can be a Twitter influencer on Web3. Web3 is one area where people want to learn, and the content is legit. Content is quite less even today, you know. So the, and by the way, this is bound to grow, and the content in regional language is lacking. So somebody wants to learn Web3 in Gujarati, like Punjab has got a money, but Punjab doesn't have a local Punjabi channel, content channel. So then you also have, you know, regional channels in, you can make content in regional channels. Then you have, you want legal, you want people in as a chartered accountants, you you want people in forensic audits, you need people in, you know, HR. HR is very critical, because HR is very critical job in this ecosystem, because most of the people are working from remote and from different nations, different places. So how to bring them to, together for one mission, that's the HR job here. So there are various aspects, you know, in this space where various professionals are required, and most required at present is, you know, in the content creation side. I'll tell you, if you have some flair, and not just video, even if you can write your newsletters or blogs, I'm telling you, this industry needs very good content and legit content creators in this space.
Got it. I guess that is it for today. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining in. And please share some feedback. I've just shared a link. Thank you so much, Kashif, for doing this. And
yeah, thank you.
We spent a little half an hour, a little above. Sorry for that.
Yeah, sorry for that. Went a little. Yeah, I know. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your patience. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kashif. Thank you, everyone, for joining. Just one thing left. I would just like to take people through who are the previous winners of the contest that we are running. So every time you join a session, you write a thread, you get something from us, in NFT, crypto, or the cash prizes. So I would just would like to take some time and show them who are the previous winners that we have. Very quickly, one sec. Let me share my screen once again. So,
Om, can you just a request, if you can share my Twitter handle here, because many people are asking for that.
Yeah. I'll quickly share that. Let me do that once again. Folks, you can follow Kashif on Twitter here. I'm just pasting the link in the chat. And Sudhanshu was the winner of the session, which was done by Jayant Ramanan from Mantra Rao. Soyash is one of the winners who wrote a beautiful thread on building and raising on blockchain. You saw Amjad's thread on when we learned what is DeFi, starting from building on blockchain again, adding to the same thing. And we had Sabir Khan who wrote a very decent thread about the second session that we had with Edul from Mudrex. And this is one more, the very first session, Web 3.0, the inaugural session that we did, Namrata was the winner. And today as well, the contest is live from right now. Whatever you learn from Kashif, put it in a thread, put it out on socials. Kashif will also love to see what you all gained up, and you'll get something from us. And that's how we move forward. I think, thank you so much. I think that was it from our side. Thank you so much, Kashif. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining in. And I wish you all a very good night, and we'll see you probably in the next session. Thank you.